God has a future and a hope for his people. There are times of chastening because of disobedience, but there are also times of restoration. And so, as a child of God, those who have put their trust and faith in the Lord Jesus, we know that there's restoration in Jesus. For Israel, there was a promise that God gave them in the book of Isaiah that there'd be a season that would come where that chastening would be over. And chapter 35 addresses it. And actually, the fulfillment of that restoration is found in the Messiah, because this is really a messianic psalm, a messianic chapter. So what I'd like to do is, I just want to read through chapter 35, and I want you to think about hope. I want you to think about how this was a message of hope to those captives. But then we're going to bring it around to us today, and especially focus on verses 3 and 4. So follow along with me, and then take special note of verses 3 and 4 when we read through, and then we'll start with a word of prayer. Chapter 35, verse 1. The wilderness and the wasteland shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice, even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the excellence of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the excellency of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are fearful-hearted, be strong, do not fear. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, with the recompense of God. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For waters shall burst forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. In the habitation of jackals, where each lay, there shall be grass with reeds and rushes. A highway shall be there, and a road, and it shall be called the highway of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for others. Whoever walks the road, although a fool, shall not go astray. No lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up on it. It shall not be found there. But the redeemed shall walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing, with everlasting joy on their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Verses 3 and 4. Strengthen the weak hands, make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are fearful-hearted, be strong, do not fear. Father in heaven, we're asking for your ministry to us from this section of your word. We rely upon the Holy Spirit to breathe upon it, that we might hear the word of the Lord to us personally and as a congregation. Lord, these are indeed the last days, and we have a window of opportunity to make a difference day by day. So, Lord, deal with us as a congregation and as individuals in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, when you look at verse 3 and 4, you find three exhortations. The first exhortation is to strengthen the weak hands. The second exhortation is to make firm the feeble knees. And the third exhortation is, say to those who are fearful-hearted, be strong, do not fear, behold, your God will come. And as I look at these three exhortations, I see three encouragements. First of all, it deals with those who have weak hands and wobbly knees and worried hearts. And when I look at these three, I also see the exhortation to strengthen, strengthen, and strengthen. So in any congregation, you have people that have weak hands. And it has to do with the work that we do in serving the Lord. So think of the word work. And those who have wobbly knees or weak knees or feeble knees, and this would be the walk in the Lord. There are those that are just not wanting to take another step forward in faith because there's been so much failure and so many reasons, which we'll talk about in particular. And then there are those that have fearful hearts and fear has captivated their life. You know, maybe the failures have taken place in times past and there have been situations that have just collapsed and there is a fear of man or a fear of more failure and it just locks you down. But then as a congregation, we are to come alongside those who are of fearful hearts and give the promises of God and make God the focus rather than the circumstances. And so we have the work, the walk, and the will that we're going to be addressing here this morning. So let's take a look at the very first exhortation. Strengthen the failing hands, the weak hands. And this has to do with the work of faith. This is God telling Israel, don't be condemned, but this is comfort to you. This is consolation to you. Your season of chastening is about to end. And so even though your hands are weak, your hands are tired, your hands are feeble, your hands are exalted, your arms are drooping down, it is time now to be strengthened. It is a time of refreshing that's to come from the presence of the Lord. You know, when I read this, I see a picture of discouragement. I see arms that are just hanging down, and there's discouragement that is just the word that pops up in my mind. And you know, our hands are instruments of service when we serve the Lord. With our hands, we touch and we comfort. With our hands, we serve our Lord and serve others. They're instruments of service. But I want to tell you, in ministry, in your own personal families, or in your workplace, or with other brethren, there are times that your hands grow weak. And I've been a believer a long time, and I've had those seasons where my hands have just grown weak. You're tired in the work. You're not tired of the work, but you get tired in the work. And you just can't lift anything again. And the hands hang down. Maybe it's because of chastening, like it happened with Israel. But sometimes it's the result of expectations that never came about. How we view things. And we've lost perspective. And Satan uses it to shut us down. Even in raising your family, you have expectations for your children, and as they get older, all of a sudden they're starting to go wayward, and you've done everything you're supposed to do, and it's like you're losing control, and you say, what more can I do? And your hands just get weak, and you go, it's hopeless. Well, the Lord is in charge of your family. If you have released your family to the Lord, sometimes God allows you to come to a place of weakness because he resists the proud and you're trying to control your family your way and you're not committing them to the Lord. I know what that's like. I've had those seasons where I'm trying to control my kids. Sorry, Jess. Yeah. And you know, then you go through the brokenness and then there's the weak hands. And then it's like, okay, where do you go? The only hope I have is to say, okay, God, I have to let them go to you. Not just let them go, but let them go to you. I have to commit them to you. I have to put them at the foot of the cross and let go. Because God has a plan for their life, amen? And he's not telling you. Well, how come he's not telling you? Because you'd probably mess it up. So, you know, God does his best work, you know, in secret. Times of weak hands. But you know, Hebrews chapter 10, verses 35 and 36 says something important to us. Therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward, for you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. Strengthening weak hands is bringing people back to what God wants to do and to His promises. Look at Hebrews 10, verses 10 through 12. Hebrews 6, verses 10 through 12. For God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown toward His name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. And we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. You know, in this last couple of verses here, it has past, present, and future that's addressed. You've done a good work. You're doing a work right now, and God is going to take you through to the end. And sometimes we lose perspective because life is not treating us right. And we just don't want to do anything else. And I mean, we're just done. That's a scary place to be, where your hands are so weak, you don't even want to take another effort to serve the Lord, to serve His people. You're just done. Maybe those weak hands have come through people that you really trusted in, and they stabbed you in the back. And you go, I don't want to serve anybody anymore. I get hurt every time I try. But I want you to think about this. Sometimes we choose to leave the knife in our back just to prove how bad we were treated. And we kind of use it as kind of a trophy. And it's the first thing, you know, it just kind of sticks out. It's the first thing that we tell people. Oh, I've been really treated bad. Check it out, you know. And so here's the knife. And we're saying, God, please heal my heart. Well, the problem is, you're leaving the knife in. It is not going to get healed as long as the knife stays, right? But yet, if I take the knife out, nobody's going to know how badly I was treated. There's a problem with that thinking. You're never going to get healed until you take the knife out of your back. Well, yeah, but if I do that, they'll get away with it. Wait a second. What's more important? That everybody knows how badly you were treated, or to have your heart healed? You can't have it both ways. And so the exhortation here is to take the knife out and lay it at the foot of the cross and let go. And ask God to heal your heart. And I want to tell you, He will heal your heart. And don't be putting the knife back in. So if there are those who have wounded you, you have to ask your question before the Lord. Am I leaving the knife in my back? Because I tell you what, with that knife in the back, you're going to end up with a critical spirit. And it's going to crush love. Until you come to the place where you take the knife out in faith and lay it before the Lord and let go of how badly you were treated, and you're committing it to God. How can we be healed? How can our weak hands be strengthened, encouraged, and be energized? It can only come by the power of God through the Holy Spirit in the midst of our brokenness. Brokenness causes good ground, just like dead things make up good soil. And so the Holy Spirit has to bring that about in our lives. But we have to become real with Him. I'm reminded of what happened a long time ago when Israel was trying to rebuild their temple. They'd been in captivity for 70 years, and then they came back, and they're in the process of rebuilding the temple. And the governor, Zerubbabel, and the high priest Joshua had come down with 50,000 others. And the first couple of years, they laid the foundation of the temple. Everybody's excited, and some are crying because it's just not the same as it used to be and all. And then trouble from the enemies came, and fear came in. And you know, the work stopped for the next 14 years. And then people were taking building materials that were graciously given for the rebuilding of the temple. And they were taking it home. And they were going, you know, this paneling looks pretty good in my house. And they were taking all of the materials to rebuild the temple. And they were taking them home because they go, well, you know, maybe we shouldn't be doing this. The time has not come, the time to build the Lord's house. And so finally, after 14 years, that's a long time, God raised up Haggai and Zechariah, the two prophets, to encourage them to get back to work. But the thing is, he told them, now you have to go up to the mountain and cut down wood and bring it. So now it's going to be a lot harder, but it'll get done. And so for those of us that have just kind of succumbed to weak hands, how can we get back on track? It's going to be harder, because you're going to have to push against the feelings and the momentum of discouragement. And you're going to have to hear the word of the Lord, be strong. Because that was the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel in Zechariah 4, verses 6 to 7. This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Who are you, O great mountain? Referring to the huge obstacle in front of them. Before Zerubbabel, you shall become a plain, and he shall bring forth the capstone with shouts of grace, grace to it. I want to tell you that when discouragement completely overwhelms your life, there are two areas of focus that you need to do. Number one, it's a practical area. Eat right. Eat a balanced diet. What kind of counsel is that? What is this? Some kind of Amway meeting? You know, no, I'm just saying, listen, you know, sometimes when you get depressed and discouraged, you just stop. And that doesn't help at all. But you have to get back to doing natural things like eating a balanced diet for this member of the Lord's body. You know, your body's a temple of the Holy Spirit. And do some exercise, do some walking, and try to get some sleep. You know, those are natural things. Just to try to say, Lord, I want you to balance out my body here, balance out my life. But then there's that second most important thing, and that's the spiritual aspect, where you're getting yourself before the Lord and you're confessing. You know, your focus hasn't been on Him. Lord, fill me with the Holy Spirit. Bring me back on track. Bind the work of Satan against my life, using this to keep me down. And Lord, breathe on me anew. Fill me to overflowing once again with the Holy Spirit. Get me back on track. Let 2017 be a bonus year in my life. Amen. You know, it's better than New Year's resolutions. Strengthen the weak hands. You as a church have an obligation before the Lord to strengthen weak hands in your congregation, and not just be a part of your own life and your own family, and that's all we focus on is us. And if it doesn't serve us, then I don't like it. Wait a second. God's put you in the body of Christ, in this particular member, to strengthen weak hands. Because God is going to bring in people with weak hands. He's going to bring them in. And he wants you to be his hands and feet to touch them. So there's individuals that need healing, and as a church, there's an exhortation to get out of the private mindset. I mean, you're not British, you know. It's not like privacy. Come on now, we're part of a family, and we're to minister to one another. And let 2017 be a great year for that. You look across the street and you see those buildings going up, and there are hundreds of families represented by that building across the street. And there's going to be people that are going to be making their way here because it's convenient. And here's a huge opportunity. But you got to set your heart. You got to see it the way He sees it. And just take, okay, 2017, bonus year, I'm going for it. I'm putting the pedal to the metal. I'm shoving the throttle up. And let's just see what happens. If I hit the wall, I hit the wall. But I've got to try. Amen?
Amen.
Some of you this morning really have weekends. And it doesn't really matter how it happened, but that's the current situation. And right now, I want to stop and I want to pray for you. And it's not just me, I want us to pray for you. But what I'm going to ask you to do is I'm going to ask you, if this is your situation right now in your life, if before the Lord you would just stand so that we can pray for you. Could you do that? If any of you here, what I've addressed here refers to your life, and you're just at that point of weak hands, would you stand, please? Anyone else? We all have seasons like this. And it could be your season right now, and the Lord is just addressing that. Okay, for the rest of us, because we're called to strengthen the weak hands, I'd like you to go over to those that are standing. Look around, please. Don't let anybody be by themselves, because we're going to pray for them quickly. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for hope that's in Jesus. And we are asking right now, Lord, for you, the healer, that you would strengthen these weak hands. Lord, you would honor these that have stood before you. Lord, you know the reason, and you know the hurt, you know the difficulty, but you also know the future. By the power of God, Lord, would you fill them with overflowing Holy Spirit? And would you be the healer of their life? Would you strengthen their weak hands? Lord, would you give them new vision, new perspective for the future? This day, Lord, mark this day, the 29th of January. May things begin to turn, Lord. Give them a token for good. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, church. Let's take a look at the second exhortation now. Strengthen the weak hands. Strengthen the feeble knees. And this really addresses our walk in faith. While the hands represent the work, the feeble knees represent the walk. I mean, some of you, because of your athletic experiences when you were younger, have wobbly, weak knees right now. Maybe you've had a knee replacement. And, you know, it's kind of an interesting to have a knee replacement, just the whole process of that. You know, when you consider the rapture of the church, and if you happen to get a bone replacement from someone who's not saved, then that bone stays here, and the rest of your body gets glorified. Which is going to be like an interesting little dynamic, you know, when that happens. But especially if you have a pig valve in your heart, that thing's going to be, you know, it's just going to be left behind because it's not part of your glorified body. It's just weird thoughts that come to my mind. That's all. Feeble knees. What are feeble knees? Feeble knees are tottering knees, knees that give way. Rubbery knees, wobbly knees. These are all, you know, from different Bible translations. Thank you. And it's really a description of coming to the point where you're not able to take one more step forward in faith in what's in front of you. You know, you started off with such courage, such faith, so many confirmations of what God was going to do. But you took steps of faith and it just crashed. And through life circumstances, you don't want to take a risk anymore. I remember being at places in my life, in my walk, where I've heard of other brethren being excited and taking steps of faith, and my heart has so yearned to have that back again. But I had come to the place of just being so careful and being in maintenance mode, I just didn't want to take another step. But let me tell you, the Christian life is full of adventure. It's supposed to be. It's part of the abundant life. It's not that we're reckless, but yet faith involves risk every time. Faith involves, it's a reasonable faith, amen? But still it's faith. There's that gap. And every time you take a step of faith, it could fail. But God has called us to be men and women of faith. The just shall live by faith. I trust the Lord. I trust His promises, but I've got to act upon it. And what happens if, and we're so concerned about what might happen wrong that it overwhelms what might happen right. And our knees are tottering. They give way. They're rubbery. There's no stability. We're unable to stand strong. There's loss of vision. There's loss of courage. There's loss of confidence. Listen, healing takes place in your knees much longer than we anticipate. The knees are so vital in our walk. They're like the wheels. If our knees get blown out, we're not walking. I mean, it's kind of like the pivot point between the ground and the rest of our body. Amen? And, you know, we've watched the athletics, you know, Super Bowl's coming up next weekend and all. And you know, there's going to be people that are playing, those players there, and as much as they have prepared their bodies and prepared their minds, somebody's going to get their knee blown out because of just the nature of it. People in England don't understand, you know, how come everybody has to wear pads? I mean, no, because rugby is like padless. And it's like, oh, I love my broken collarbone. You know, it's, I just love when it sticks out like that. You know, after, and, you know, it's amazing. I still don't understand rugby. You gotta talk to this guy over here. He understands rugby. But let me tell you, make firm the feeble knees. Because in a congregation, there are those men and women that did have a season of strong faith. And they took steps of faith. But because of things that have happened, that seems to have shut down in their life. I've felt that before. I don't like it. And I just can't pretend to find it. God has to be the one to renew vision. The scripture says, without a vision, the people perish. And it has to do with knowledge and all. But it also touches upon that issue of purpose, sense of identity, sense of future. Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 to 3 says, brethren, and I'm going to put it in the Amplified because it just stretches it out and fills it out. Brethren, if any person is overtaken in misconduct or sin of any sort, you who are spiritual, who are responsive to and controlled by the Spirit, should set him right and restore and reinstate him without any sense of superiority and with all gentleness, keeping an attentive eye on yourself, lest you should be tempted also. Endure, carry one another's burdens and troublesome moral faults, and in this way fulfill and observe perfectly the law of Christ the Messiah. and complete what is lacking in your obedience to it. For if any person thinks himself to be somebody too important to condescend to shoulder another's load, when he is nobody of superiority except in his own estimation, he deceives and deludes and cheats himself. When a team is playing their sport and one of the members of the team gets their knee blown out on the field, then what happens? They come alongside, come underneath them, and help them off the field, right? Because they can't put weight on it anymore. And so you come along. You don't like pick him up and carry him so much, but you help him off the field, right? That's what's supposed to happen in the body of Christ. Because we are in a spiritual warfare, and sometimes our knees get blown out. And as a body of Christ, if we're not looking out for those who are hurting, we're missing part of our calling. I remember 2 years ago when our visa got canceled and we were told we couldn't come back into the UK. Our sponsor had their license revoked while we were out of the country, and we were told that we couldn't get back in the UK for a year. And I'm going, you can't tell me that. Well, that's just how it is. What? That's not right. Well, it's just how it is. And you know, the drama that happened at that time in our life was like, what's happened? What about, what if, and you know, it's just like everything is like collapsing. And then, you know, at the end of the day, you go, wait a minute. We have to try. I mean, the thought of being turned back and having to pay for one-way tickets back at the last minute in another 10-hour flight is not something pleasant. But you know what? You just got to try. We had a return ticket. It was paid for. And we just got to try. And so Jeannie and I just said, let's do this. And let's just see what happens. You know, God hasn't brought us all this way just to drop us. And I have no clue what's going to happen. So it just so happened, quotes, that the elder of our church in Exeter, we had a late night last night. The elder of our church in Exeter is a captain for British Airways. He got the flight from Phoenix to Heathrow. So he says, Bob, here's what we'll do. I'll be on the other side of passport control. And if I see them taking you off to a side room, I'll know that the two churches you're pastoring are going to lose their pastor, and we'll just have to, you know, we'll have to deal with it. But if you do get through, I'll just drive you to Exeter. It's like a 3-hour drive, 4-hour drive, really. Well, with him, 2 hours. He used to be a fighter pilot in the Desert Storm. He used to train Saudi pilots. Yeah, he drives like that. So we're going, okay. So we get on the flight. And we're going, okay, God, this is like smuggling Bibles into China. How's this going to work? So we get to passport control line. And I'm going, okay, Lord, I'm counting every single place in line you have ordained. And so where I'm at in line is where I'm supposed to be. And, you know, people cut in front of me. That's good. That's fine. And there's 24 passport control booths. I'm going, okay, Lord, you just pick the one we're supposed to go to. I mean, it was like, and then you're standing at the line and you're going, okay, this is it. This is it. And, you know, we went in and gave them our passports. They looked at it, put it through the machine, looked at our visa, put it through the machine, stamped both the passports, slid them back. Not one question. Not one. We didn't offer any anything. And we got the passports and just kind of, walk through, and he's on the other side going, you know, like this. And then later in the month, we got a new visa with a new sponsor. We're all set. 3 years. Yes, this is great. And then 6 months later, our new sponsor gets their license revoked, and we're free agents again like the NFL. And it's like, okay. I mean, there are things in life that can just knock your knees out. But you can't quit. God's the healer of wobbly knees. Amen? I just want to say that in a congregation this size, there are those that have come to the place where they don't want to step out in faith anymore. It's too risky. Too much potential for collapse and hurt again. Danger. I could lose so much. The sense of adventure is gone. You're just in maintenance mode. You're just walking through life. And like we did before, if this is you, we want to pray that God brings healing to your spiritually wobbly knees. So if this is you this morning, I'd like you to stand so we can pray for you. Is there anybody here? Okay. Anyone else? You're just at that point. You don't want to take any more steps of faith. It's too risky. And God wants you to, like, man up, as they would say. New steps of faith. Anyone else? Okay. Okay, church. You take a look around at those who have stood. Let's go over and put your hand on them. Let's pray for them now. Back here. Our Father in heaven, you are the healer of feeble knees. You created us, Lord. You've designed us to be men and women of faith and courage. And we're asking right now, God, for a healing touch upon the lives of these that have stood. We ask, God, that you would infuse into their heart a sense of courage to take new steps of faith in their life unto you, to trust your promises, to let 2017 be a year of really relying upon you in their walk, to breathe new life into their Christian life. Lord, that you'd strip away those behaviors that are absolutely detrimental to their walk of faith. Flush out that mindset that fights against all that you want to do in their life. Lord, we trust you with this prayer for them. Acknowledge our prayers for them. In Jesus' name, amen. And finally, we come to the third exhortation, strengthen the fearful hearts. And this has to do with the will, our resolve. God has called us to be soldiers, men and women who are soldiers in this life of serving the Lord. We are called pilgrims and strangers. Whether you've been in the same house for your whole life and, you know, three generations back, or whether you've been in the service and have moved around dozens of times, God has called you to be a pilgrim and a stranger. This world is not your home. Sometimes we just have to, like, take a break from social media and from all the news and just say, you know, God, I need to fast from all of that input, and I need to be brought back to your worldview, your perspective. God has a plan for all of us, because there are times when a fearful heart can just be brought to so control us that it puts us in a catatonic state. We're so captivated by fear that the peace is gone. Where's this peace that passes understanding? Where's this joy unspeakable and full of glory that comes with the freedom that you know that God is absolutely in charge? He's in charge. Psalm 118 says, it's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. What's it like to have a fearful heart? I know that the captives, when they came back, referring to our example with Israel, rebuilding the temple, the captives, when they came back, were so fearful of their enemies that they stopped doing what God had set before them to do. I'm sure they came back from Babylon to Jerusalem and so full of hope, so full of courage, so full of purpose and vision, willing to do whatever it took. And then their enemies came in and crushed the work, crushed the will through fear. And let me tell you, the arena of the enemy of our soul is fear. If he can get you fearful, he can stop you. And you end up pulling yourself out of the ranks. God's arena is faith. He wants you to step, he wants us to step from the arena of fear into the arena of faith, because that's where God is going to work. The exhortation is, say to those who are fearful-hearted, be strong. Do not fear. Easy for you to say. No, because when you're fearful hearted, I mean, you ever been in a bad situation and people say, oh, it's okay, God really loves you. And you're so down, you go, shut up. You don't want to hear it because you're so down. But wait a minute. The Holy Spirit uses the truth spoken. And so when you seek to encourage somebody in love and with sensitivity, don't you know that the Holy Spirit wants to use that message to come in and do what words can't do? Say to those who are fearful-hearted, be strong, do not fear. Do you know how many times Jesus said that to his disciples? It is I, do not be afraid. Really, you know, when the Lord is with us, there's no reason to be afraid. But while we can sure close down through fear. And I tell you what, sometimes we say, you know, I just don't want to be wounded anymore. But young David, I'm sure, had scars on his life from fighting with the lion and the bear. Look at 1 Samuel 17, verses 34 through 37. When David was about to go fight Goliath. Consider it carefully. David said to Saul, your servant used to keep his father's sheep. And when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck and killed it. Forget the slingshot. We're talking close encounters of the third kind. Your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he's defied the armies of the living God. Moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. When you're grabbing a lion or a bear by its beard to pull a lamb out of its mouth, don't you think there's a scratch or two involved with that process? The text doesn't say, but realistically, those are scars that probably never left his life. And yet he could look at the scars and say, the Lord who delivered me. The scar becomes a reminder of God's victory. Are we so concerned that we look good that we're afraid for having scars and wounds from others or from situations? Listen, our life shouldn't be live fast, die young, make a good-looking corpse. That's not the rule of our life as a believer. Those wounds are supposed to be victory scars because God has healed them, and every wound is a reminder of that testimony of what God did. Look at Jesus. Do you know he has the wounds still? He has the wound in his side. Those wounds are victory scars. Amen? You've been wounded. God wants to heal it and show his testimony, because it's not over yet. This past year was one of the hardest my wife and I have ever had. But at the end of the year, you know, it's been great. It hurts. Be strong. Do not fear. Say to those who are fearful-hearted, be strong. Be of good courage. Do not be afraid. Do not be dismayed. For the Lord thy God will be with you wherever you go. I'd like us all to stand, because we all need a touch from the Lord.